Hello everyone, today is 6th of July. My name is Sahil and welcome to the newspaper analysis. Guys, in today's session, we will be doing the complete news analysis of the Hindu newspaper and we will also be taking up the selected relevant articles from the Mint newspaper as well as the Business Standard. Now guys, first of all, let's see the relevant articles into the Mint and the Business Standard. So the first article that we are going to take is the surge into the covered bonds which have been seen. So what are these covered bonds? How they are different from the regular bonds? All such kind of things we'll be seeing here. Then guys, now the rise of duopoly we can see into the startup culture in India, how it can be problematic and how the Competition Commission of India needs to act, such kind of an attachment we will be taking up. The similar thing has been carried into the Business Standard also. Then guys, this article has been taken from the Business Standard. It talks about the opening of Cowin platform for the world and we will see that how it might be a step to enhance India's soft power into the post-pandemic world. Then guys, this article has been taken from the Mint newspaper and it talks about the changing geopolitical contours into the changing times. So we will be seeing this also. Now guys, taking up the overview of the Hindu and then we'll be doing the detailed discussion. Here, this is the page number one and we can see that the tribal rights activist Father Stan Swamy had passed away due to the complications he developed after the COVID-19. He was lodged into the prison into the Mumbai. Now guys, he was arrested because of the role which allegedly he played into the Bhima Koregaon incident. Now, there are various viewpoints which have developed. The issue has become very much politically flared up, where it has been said that the government is showing a kind of an authoritarianism when the matter pertained to the release of Father Stan Swamy. And because of that particular negligence, he had died. Guys, don't need to go into such kind of matters. Then guys, here we can see that the CBSE has decided to cut syllabus and to hold the examinations in November and April for the next year. Guys, such kind of details are very much volatile and as they are very much temporary, they are not needed for our UPSC examination. Then guys, here we can see that the Section 66A of the IT Act is still being used. Now, Section 66 was said as unconstitutional by the Supreme Court into the Shreya Singhal case. It was said that the provision is very much vague, it should not be utilized, but still it is being utilized. So this is the thing. Then guys, after that, we can see that the facial recognition is still being used by the Ministry of Home Affairs, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, when there is no specific mandate. So we will see this thing. Then guys, further moving, we have the city page, but here nothing relevant news with respect to the UPSC is there. Fine. So we will be moving to the editorial page. On to the editorial, guys. This particular article talks about the controversy and conspiracy theory with respect to the origin of COVID-19. Guys, such kind of things are not needed. You can please leave it. After that, this article talks about the political issues into the Punjab, how the Chief Minister Amrinder Singh is facing a kind of a crisis, not at all important. Then guys, this particular article talks about the fraud charges that have been imposed onto the Trump organization, the company of Donald Trump. Again, not important. Guys, this article is talking about the high number of deaths. As the government said that the government's data was very much low. So the high number of deaths are being talked about into this article. Then guys, this article talks about the India-Africa relations and into that capacity, a very important article, we will see this thing. Then guys, the idea of national judiciary, we will again see this thing. Then guys, the below article talking about the political issues in Punjab, not at all important. Then guys, on to the next page, here we can see that mainly the political articles have been given, which are not important. Then going to the next page, so guys, here we can see that again, the political news and all such kind of things have been talked about. And finally, guys, here again, the Cowin platform has been talked. We will discuss it. Then guys, here we can see that the National Achievement Survey is being talked about, which will be carried under Nipun Bharat. We will see what it is. After that, guys, moving on to the next page. Here we can see again that into the Afghanistan, the Taliban is wreaking their havoc. The Afghan troops are also fleeing. Already yesterday, we have taken up why this particular issue is happening. Then guys, the other news are not very much important here. Then guys, on to the business page, here we can see that Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan has been flagged and at the same time, the space policy of India has also been flagged. So we will see that what all these issues are. So guys, that is all about the today's newspaper overview and now let's discuss these articles one by one. Now guys, starting up with the today's newspaper analysis and first we will be taking up the GS quote. So today we will be taking a quote from the Aristotle, the Greek philosopher. He says, "It is the mark of an educated mind to be able to entertain a thought without accepting it." Now guys, it has been provided here by the Aristotle that education also induces a level of tolerance into the society. Because when the tolerance comes, we accept this particular thing that there could be a diversity of opinions which can exist, and even those opinions might not be going in sync with our own ideological framework. But as we have our own ideology, those opposing viewpoints also have a right to exist. So such kind of intellectual maturity or an ethical maturity is induced by the education. So this is the role of education that has been highlighted by the Aristotle. So guys, rather than just the intellectual values, the ethical values are also inculcated. Guys, we can utilize this particular quote into the answers related to the GS paper number 1, GS paper number 2, as well as into the answers related to the GS paper number 4 under the topic of teachings by the great philosophers. So that is all for the today's GS quote. And now let's take the newspaper analysis one by one. Now guys, taking up the first article. So this article has been taken up from the Mint newspaper, and it will be important under GS paper number 3 under the topic of issues related to the Indian economy. Now guys, into this particular article, it has been provided that into this particular last fiscal year, that is 2020-2021, the covered bonds have become very much popular. And this particular thing we can see by our data which has been collected from the ICRA Limited report. It has been provided that into the last financial year, 2,218 crore worth of covered bonds have been issued, and never such kind of milestone has been achieved. We can see guys, for example, into the financial year 2019, just 25 crore rupees of these covered bonds were issued. So why now they are becoming so popular? We will be seeing all this thing. Now guys, when we talk about these covered bonds, they are also called as the bankruptcy remote bonds. Okay, so please keep this name also into your mind. Now, before going into this particular article, let's talk about some of the most basic things. Now guys, first of all, understanding that what these bonds mean. So whenever a particular person or any particular corporate wants to start its business, it will obviously be needing the money. Now you can raise the money by two, three important sources. Number one is that you can take the money as a loan from some person, and you can ask him that, okay, you give me money and I will be giving you such percent interest rate. For example, every year I will give you 8% interest or 10% interest. The other way could be that you can go to the people and you can say them, okay, you buy the shares of my company, and the number of shares that you will be buying, you will get a kind of an ownership into the company. And whenever the company will be making a profit, you will get the share of profit in proportion to the shares that you are holding. If the profit is more, you might get more. If the profit is less, you might get less also. However, into the people who have given the money as a part of our debt, there is a surety of money that they will be getting. So guys, basically, the bonds are such kind of an arrangement where a person is giving the money and in return, he will be receiving a sure short interest rates. So many a times, these bonds are also called as the debentures because they are the debt instruments. Fine. So this is the bond. Now guys, into the regular bonds, what happens whenever a company wants to raise the money, it will be going to a credit rating agency. The credit rating agency will be giving them a rating, for example, AA+ or AA. Or any such kind of a rating will be given. Onto that particular basis, it will be basically told that how much risky an investment is into that particular company. So guys, basically the companies whose credit rating is not very good, they have to give higher interest rate in order to attract the people. However, onto the opposite hand, the companies whose credit rating is very good, they don't need to give high interest rate. Rather, at the low interest rate also, they can ask for the money. And even people will invest because they know this thing that their investment will always be safe. Okay, so this is the way in which normal bonds and the bond work. Now, guys, these are covered bonds. Basically, this is a kind of a new experiment that is being done. Here, what happens? Suppose there is one particular corporate that is ABC. It says that, okay, we want to raise some money via the way of debt. They will go to the people that, okay, please give us the money. But these people might say that your credit worthiness is not that much good. So what can be done? This ABC will say that, okay, we are taking the 100 crore rupees loan, but in return, we will keep aside our assets of 100 crore rupee or similar amount of assets we will be keeping aside. And this asset, we will not keep it with us. We will be keeping this particular asset into a independent trust. So if we go bankrupt, if our company fails, you have a surety that the asset equivalent to that particular money is lying there into that trust. You can claim your money from there. So because of this particular thing, people get more trust onto this. And guys, the credit rating agencies independently even rate these covered bonds also. And because the asset underlying is secured into a trust, many a times this possibility is also there that the company which is issuing the covered bonds, that company's credit rating might be low, but these covered bonds rating might be higher. So that particular possibility is also there. Now guys, when the companies are raising money by these covered bonds, they get an advantage because usually these bonds are very much secured and credit rating agencies give them a good rating. So for this particular bond, they can raise money at the low interest rate. So this particular advantage comes to the people who are raising money, as well as the investor also get a benefit. That is, number one, their investments are very much secured. There is no problem. Number two is this, that guys, basically the companies which are now raising these covered bonds, they are into the sector such as the gold loan, vehicle loan, small loan, wholesale loan. Now they have a kind of an inherent potential that they can offer relatively more than the government bonds. So number one, inherently little bit more interest is there. Secondly guys, what happens, there is a tax benefit also which comes. Now see, whenever these bonds are being issued, these covered bonds, they are presented as the MLDs. That is the market linked debentures. Now, when you sell a market linked debenture after 1 year, there is a 10% tax that is charged onto the return that you have made. But guys, the normal bonds, when they are sold, they attract a capital gain tax of 20%. So in terms of the tax treatment also, these covered bonds are very much favorable. And now guys, we have seen that after the pandemic, the markets are very much subdued. Even the people who have kept their money into the fixed deposit, because fixed deposit are very sure, there the interest rate is very much less, around 5% interest rate is coming. So now people are exploring more options where their money will be safe and they can get a relatively higher returns in the FD. So into that particular capacity, these bankruptcy remote bonds or covered bonds are fitting. So therefore now people are buying it and more interest is being shown here. Fine. So guys, these are all the advantage as well as benefits of these particular bond. Fine, you can see them here onto the screen also. So I hope you have understood it, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article here, we have clubbed the two articles from the Business Standard as well as from the Hindu newspaper. Clear? Now guys, this particular article can be utilized as an attachment in our GS paper number 2, where we can show that the steps that have been taken into the aftermath of COVID-19 by India to enhance the soft power. Now guys, first of all, before going into this, what is this soft power that I have talked about? See, soft power is a concept was given by the Joseph Nye. He says that the soft power is that power that a particular country is having, fine, by which it attracts the people by the virtue of its culture, by the virtue of its tradition, its spirituality, philosophies, etc. Clear? Guys, the concept of power is very simple. What is power? Power is simply my ability to my ability to influence you to do whatever I want. That is my power. Fine. If you will do whatever I want, it means I have a power. Now the power can be exercised by the hard mean. Fine. I can put a gun at your forehead and I can ask you to do this thing. You will do. That is hard power. Then there could be the economical intimidation or an economic power. I will give you the money. You will do that thing. Then there is soft power. I had made such a good relation with you that whatever I'll say, you will do that thing. So this is a soft power, and soft power is a kind of an important vertical in any country's foreign policy. Now guys, as the pandemic started, what India has done to enhance the soft power? Number one, we gave the ideology of one earth, one health. We said that there is the pandemic is a kind of a event which happens once in a century, and we need to come together, and by the way of collaborations, we need to sail this pandemic collectively. Even guys, into the WTO, India along with South Africa has proposed that the COVID-related medicines, they should be exempted from the IPR. So what it is nothing but the manifestation of one earth, one health ideology. Then guys, what happened? Vaccine Maitri we started, where we sub-exported the vaccines to so many of the countries, though it was criticized, but it was a good gesture by the India. Then guys, the Arogya Setu app, which we developed for the contact tracing, that particular app was provided as an open platform. Even other countries, even other software developers were allowed that they can utilize this particular platform. Now, guys, what has happened, coming to the present news, the government has provided that the Cowin platform that we are using for administering the vaccine, it will be provided as an open software, open platform. Clear? And this open platform will be helping the tech-enabled vaccination into the other countries also, the countries which don't have that much of resources or the countries which don't have too much of time to create a kind of an entirely new platform. They can directly borrow this Cowin platform. Guys, it has been said that the vaccination is to be carried indispensably by this such kind of tech-enabled platform, because now there are so many of the vaccines which are being given. So, and these vaccines are to be given into the multiple doses. So, how you will identify that whether a person A earlier got the Covishield vaccine or Covaxin or some other kind of vaccine? In every country, multiple vaccines are being given. So, tech platform is very much needed, and now India is giving it to all the countries. Now, guys, this particular announcement has been made by India at the Cowin Global Conclave, which was attended by the representatives of 142 countries, and 50 countries have even shown interest in taking or borrowing this Cowin platform. So, guys, it is a victory of India's soft power. Fine. So, this is particular development that has happened here. Fine, guys, you can utilize well it in your examples. And guys, I say that more contemporary examples you will be using into your answer related to GS2 and GS3, more substantial marks you will be getting. So that is all here, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, guys, taking up the next article. So this article has been taken from the Mint newspaper, and here we can see that it has been provided that what is the new order that is coming into the geopolitics today? What are the new challenges that are coming? What are the new contours that are being framed? So guys, this particular attachment you can utilize into the GS paper number 2 under the topic of international relation and emerging global trends, global orders, etc. Now guys, here into this article it has been said that the geopolitics right now is being shaped at the three levels. At number one level, there are the superpowers, and it has been said that the US and China are the superpowers. Okay, US is already an established superpower, and China is very near to that. So it has been considered that yes, it has also arrived there. Then guys, at the second level, it has been said that they are the traditional powers, the countries which are there into the G7. And third, there are the emerging powers, such as the India, find the countries such as the South Africa, etc. These are Russia, they have been called as the emerging powers. Okay, now it has been provided that the emerging powers, find particularly guys, here I mean India, is not aspiring to become a traditional power, rather it wants to jump to the status of superpower. Is it clear? And into this particular capacity, the country needs to understand the present going geopolitics. This is the basic premise. Now guys, here it has been said that number one, when we talk about at the level of superpowers, there is a kind of a difference in opinion which is going on, and this difference in opinion will be shaping the coming world order. In this direction, first of all, we will see that what are the issues onto which the two superpowers are not converging. So guys, here we can see that first of all, the superpowers, they don't agree onto the underlying values which will be the major driving forces. For example, onto the principle of governance, the purpose of the state, the concept of privacy and its extent, the understanding of public goods, the rule of law, the separation of judiciary from the executive. Onto this particular thing, unanimity is not there. For example, the America is a liberal, more of a liberal democracy, and it believes that the privacy needs to be given, there needs to be adequate separation between the different organs, the state should not interfere into the rights of the people, but China doesn't believe into this particular thing. So guys, now this is the major divergence that is there into the superpowers. After that, guys, it has been said that it is not the first time such a kind of a divergence is there. Even during the time of the Cold War, or the Soviet Russia, and USA was also having similar kind of divergence. But guys, now the order is changing. Now even a bigger aspect is also there where the divergence has come. That is onto the aspect of the technology as well as data. Now guys, what has been seen? We have seen that today the data and the technology are the major drivers in any of the aspect, into the health sector, into the economy, into the even the warfare now will be carried by the cyber technologies. So these are the areas where the progress is needed. Guys, earlier what happened? Earlier the Russia and the US, they were competing in terms of developing more and more nuclear arsenal. Now that particular thing was never coming in conflict with the normal citizens. Now the race is for the data and the technology, and this data is generated by the citizens. So many a times, guys, in order to improve their progress, many a times they also temper the citizens' privacy, citizens' right, citizens' data, and all such kind of things. So this is one broad contour that is coming. So therefore, it has been provided that, guys, now the new area of cooperation will also be needed at the superpower level. Now, these new areas of cooperation will be the cooperation onto the data. Now, guys, the cooperation with respect to the storage of data, sharing of data, the form in which the data will be kept, there is a cooperation which is needed. Then, guys, the cooperation is needed with respect to the technologies, particularly the quantum computing technology, biotech, and the cyber technologies. Now, because they can be constructive as well as destructive. So, here the cooperation is needed at the global level, particularly within the superpowers. Then, the cooperation is needed onto the communication formats. Now, guys, the 5G is bringing so much of kind of opportunities as well as challenges. So here also the new cooperation will be needed into the new global order. So that is one thing. However, at the same time, guys, the cooperation onto the conventional areas or the traditional areas will also be needed, and into this particular area, that is now a kind of a new synergy is also being seen. For example, guys, the climate earlier was a very hot topic where the convergence was not there, but now the climate has more or less been resolved. Today we can see that to address the challenge of global warming, every country is going serious for that particular thing. Into every country's agenda, the climate warming has been a particular matter. Into this capacity, even the China has now said that by 2060 they will be going for the carbon neutrality. The Europe, more than 14 countries into the Europe had adopted for the carbon neutrality. Even India is working very passionately towards the renewable energy and all such kind of things. So guys, the traditional contesting areas are now seeing a kind of a cooperation. This is one particular thing. After that, guys, it has also been said that now if we see into the space sector also, a kind of a cooperation is coming. Earlier it was an area of contention, now the cooperation is coming. Now almost all the countries are opening their space sector for the private participation. Even India has also opened it under the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan. And now, guys, even the sharing arrangement mechanisms are also being done. There is a cooperation, the satellites are being launched by the cooperation, the space stations, the agreement on their sharing is being signed. So this particular area also is now seeing a cooperation. After that, guys, even when we talk about the nuclear arsenal, which was a major source of contention, here also a kind of a stability has come, because now the countries have understood that well enough nuclear arsenal they have developed, and now it will well be working into the direction of deterrence. So this is the things which has settled. However, guys, it has also been said that with respect to the traditional areas of conflict, that is onto the tariff, trade, etc., there will be the occasional disputes which will be emerging. Moreover, it has been provided that now the world will be moving more towards the bilateral arrangement rather than the multilateral arrangement, because we have seen that the multilateral institutions such as WTO, etc., has not provided much of a success. So these are some of the broad contours that have been discussed into this particular article, that what will be the new global order. Into this, it has been said that India needs to perform its wealth role. It has been provided that India will be having the too much of the opportunities, and India needs to analyze that what are the areas where India needs to play. First of all, it has been provided that now the time has arrived that we need to work on the Quad Plus formation, under which we can negotiate some of the pressing issues which are common to the India as well as other countries. For example, guys, today we have seen that the monopoly type of situation is being created by the tech companies. For example, into the social media, the Facebook is one which is holding the dominant landscape. Similarly, the Google, Apple, they are becoming virtual monopolies, and into this direction they can abuse their position laterwards. So the Quad Plus needs to come out with such kind of mechanisms where the protocols are to be established, how they can be kept into the check, and how they can contribute product and constructively into the countries. Even, guys, when we talk about the USA is all had also seen that how a kind of a corporatocracy is being followed by these big tech companies. So into this direction, a kind of a corporation is to be done. Now, guys, it has been said that the geopolitical changes are coming into the world, and India needs to be an active player rather than being a bystander into all this particular aspect. So guys, these are all the ideas which have been provided into this article. I hope that you have understood them all. And guys, it is a very good collection of viewpoints, and you can very clearly utilize it in our GS paper number 2. So that is all. And now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this article has been taken from the Business Standard as well as a Mint newspaper. Here we have clubbed the both, and here we will be seeing one important aspect, and it can be important for our GS paper number 2 as well as GS paper number 3. Now see guys, if we see today into the world, we see that around the world, big corporates, big startups, they are gaining the ground of a big influence. And into this particular thing, they are trying to become a kind of a monopoly, or somewhere a duopoly is being created. And by the virtue of that monopoly or duopoly, into the long term, they will exploit their dominant position. Now guys, into this particular direction, I have already into the last article also talked about this aspect. See, every country is having the antitrust laws as well as antitrust regulator. Now the antitrust laws are those laws which ensure that a fair competition is maintained, and antitrust regulator is that regulator which also ensures that no company is gaining too much of influence. In India also we have the antitrust laws, and these antitrust laws are the competition law, fine, or the competition act. After that guys, into that particular thing, we also have made the antitrust institution, that is the Competition Commission of India. So this Competition Commission of India ensures that the fair level playing field is there. Now guys, here we can just see the Competition Commission. It has been created by the Competition Act of 2002. It is a body which has a chairperson and the 6 of the members, and all of them are appointed by the central government. Fine. Now guys, what has happened into the present case? It has been provided that the Swiggy and Zomato, they have created a kind of a delivery duopoly. Into this particular thing, what they are doing, they have now started to abuse the market. They are charging the premium delivery charges from the customer, and even those charges are not being shared with the restaurant owners. Rather, even a hefty commission extra they are also charging from the restaurant owners. And because of the pandemic, the reliance onto these platforms have become so much huge. So it has been said that now they are playing a kind of a duopoly, and this particular thing is not good for the competition into the India. So a kind of a petition has been sent to the Competition Commission. Moreover guys, it has also been said that this duopoly is also running their own cloud kitchens. Now first of all, let's understand that what these cloud kitchens are. So guys, cloud kitchen is a concept where there will be a kind of an establishment which will provide food, but there will be no dining. So these are also called as the ghost restaurants or the ghost kitchens. Fine. For example, you might have heard about the Behrouz Biryani. So Behrouz Biryani is a place which is delivering you the food, but there is no formal dining facility. Then the Fasos, etc. are also the these cloud kitchens. Now what has happened? The Zomato as well as Swiggy, they are basically making a kind of an arrangement where they are establishing the infrastructure. They are inviting the different chef under the different name, and they say them that okay, you cook and you sell your food onto our platforms, and into return, the basically Zomato and Swiggy, they promise that we will showcase your food and your establishments into more prominently onto our app. Now this particular thing also put the other food vendors at a disadvantage. Now guys, obviously in return, the Zomato and the Swiggy is charging much money from them, but guys, the small vendors, the small establishments onto the food, they are facing a kind of a disadvantageous position. So it has been said that the concept of running the cloud kitchens, charging premium, basically vanishing all the competition, is a direction where a duopoly is being created. Now guys, into this particular direction, we can see that Ola bought the Food Panda in 2017 just to close this particular entity, because they were also venturing into this particular direction. Fine. So here the Competition Commission of India needs to work. Now guys, traditionally, into the normal discourse also, if I told you about the performance of CCI, it has been said that it has been relatively less active when compared to the Western counterparts, because the Western competition commissions, they have been more active. For example, when the Facebook was trying to abuse its position in order to get more revenue in terms of advertising, the news agencies had dragged that particular matter, and their competition commissions had fined the Facebook, Google also. But in India, such kind of matters have not happened. So therefore, the Competition Commission needs to be more proactive, and such kind of abuse by the startups need to be checked. Fine. So this is one trend which is coming. That is all. Now guys, we'll move into the next article. Now guys, this article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and it is talking about the prospects of India into the Africa. It will be important under GS paper number 2, the international relations. Fine. Now guys, here it has been provided that when we talk about the India-Africa relations, India-Africa relations have been very much old, even during the time of Jawaharlal Nehru. Nehru talked about the Afro-Asian unity, and into that, a special place was given to the Africa. Now guys, what has happened? Just very recently, the Minister of External Affairs had visited to the Kenya, and this visit had again highlighted the importance of India-Africa relations. Now, first of all, guys, when we talk about the India-Africa relations, they have been a multifaceted relations, a multifaceted engagement has been there. For example, we have provided the Africa the line of credits, capacity building, skill development initiatives we have driven there. Then multi-sectoral cooperations have been done by the Africa. That is one thing. Success has also come. But there is one significant area or one linchpin where the relations can be carried. And this linchpin is the agriculture sector. Fine. Why? But number one, emotionally, agriculture sector is very close to the India as well as to the Africa also. Fine. If we see into the Africa, the agriculture sector basically employs more than 60% of their workforce. After that, guys, world's 65% uncultivated arable area or land is into the Africa. And thirdly, agriculture is accounting to nearly 20% of the GDP into the sub-Saharan countries. So agriculture is a major driver into the Africa. So guys, this particular area, India should reap and India should cooperate with the Africa. But guys, sadly what has happened, the China factor looms large here. Fine. Now China, because of their checkbook diplomacy, they had also ventured into the agriculture sector. Now here we can see that guys, China is one amongst the Africa's largest trading partner. It is also Africa's single biggest creditor. And because of that, heavy investments have been done into the agriculture. Moreover, guys, even the agriculture infrastructure sector, it is also being dominated by the China. Agriculture infrastructure means the warehouses, storage facilities, etc. Now, guys, further, if we see the China's engagement onto the agriculture, we can see that basically China is building the industrial parks, economic zone, fine, and these industrial park economic zone had attracted large number of low-cost labor-intensive manufacturing units also, particularly the units which are live in China. Now they are coming into the Africa. So China is proactively working into the Africa. Now, guys, we cannot say that, okay, whatever China is doing into the Africa is not very important to India. Now, it is important because, guys, if a strategic hand will be gained by Africa and by China into the Africa, then India's disadvantage will surely be there. Then further, guys, when we talk about the the human force into the Africa, it is also being supplied by the China. China is providing its own engineers, its own academics, its own researchers into the Africa, and they are also working there so that they can get a global experience and they can build the brand China into the long term. Fine. So this is a particular thing is there. Then guys, the China is also present into the tech landscape. Now the tech companies, they are laying the critical telecommunication infrastructure into the Africa, into the connectivity. They are playing a very important role. So guys, it has been the China's presence has been there in all the areas. Now, particularly when we talk about the agriculture sector, guys, what has happened? China has introduced agri-technology. Agri-technology means precision farming, fitting the farms with the sensors so that the water monitoring, etc., moisture monitoring can be done. Then, guys, the China had also developed over 20 agriculture technology demonstration centers. Now, here what has happened? Chinese agronomists, they are working to develop new varieties of crop to increase the crop yields. And now China is also collaborating with the African universities, African research centers. So into this particular way, guys, China is actually getting much of a head start into the Africa, particularly in agriculture as well as into the other areas. But guys, at the same time, there are some discord or some disputes also which are emerging. Particularly, guys, the discord has emerged because of the lopsided trade, insular diaspora, looming debt, fine, competition with the local business. Because of this particular thing, now a kind of an anti-China sentiment is also there. Basically, it has been seen that much of the technology which has been brought by China has not been suited to the local condition. The local business are complaining that China is intimidating. Then there is a kind of a social tensions which are also coming between the Chinese nationalities and the African nationalities. Now it has been said, because of these disputes, a space has been created where India can enter. And therefore, India should not miss this particular opportunity, because this opportunity will not be open for long. Fine. So what has been provided, guys, that India needs to work onto the agriculture cooperation. Right now, what we are doing, we are working onto the into the institutional as well as individual capacity. Guys, there is the India-Africa Institute of Agriculture and Rural Development, which has been established into the Malawi. Then, guys, the soft loans have been provided by India. Machinery has been provided. The farmlands have been acquired by the Indians and they are carrying the agriculture there. Moreover, at the level of the state, at the level of sub-nation, we are also coordinating. For example, guys, the Kerala is importing the cashew nuts from the Africa. 8 lakh tons a year cashew nut are being imported and a distinct brand of Africa Kolam cashew nuts have been created. So at the level of states also we are cooperating. But it has been provided that, guys, we need to enhance our cooperation more. Number one, we need to leverage agriculture, and after that on some other areas also we need to go. For example, guys, it has been provided that the startup ecosystem is thriving into the Africa. If we see, 110% growth has been seen between 2016 and 2018 into the startup ecosystem into the Africa. Now, Indian tech industry, Indian startups, they can collaborate with Africa and can explore entirely a new area there. So, therefore, this particular article advocates that India should not sit idle into the case of Africa and should not make the conditions that China can get a headway. Rather, we need to be very proactive. So that is all about this particular article, guys. I hope you have understood it. And now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, guys, this particular article again has been taken from the editorial section of the Hindu newspaper, and it is talking about the idea to create the national judiciary. It is talking about the idea to create the All India Judicial Service. Now, it will be an important article for our GS paper number 2 under the topics related to the Indian judiciary. Now, guys, first of all, when we talk about the provisions with respect to the lower level judiciary or the district judges into the Indian constitution, there is article number 233. Article 233 provides that the appointment, posting and promotion of a district judge is to be decided by the governor of a state after doing the consultation with the High Court of that particular state. Is it clear? So, guys, governor appoints the district judges. This particular scenario is there. However, guys, for long it was believed that we need to create a professionally managed and well-competent class of judicial officers which will be holding the position at the level of the district judges. It was said that it will be bringing more of a competence into the Indian judiciary. And because of that particular understanding, guys, into the 42nd Constitutional Amendment Act, we amended the article number 312 and added article 312 subclause 1, which created the provisions for the All India Judicial Services. But guys, what has happened after creation of the provisions of AIJS under 312, a kind of a dichotomy has been created between article 233 and article number 312. Now, how the dichotomy has been created? Because, guys, under article number 233, appointment of a district judge is being made as a prerogative of a state government. But under article number 312, the parliament has been given a power that it can create the All India Judicial Service. So, basically, a clash between the center and the state has come, and it has become more of a kind of a federal issue into the India. It has been said. Though, because of this particular aspect, whenever the AIJS idea comes, it has been criticized by the state governments also. But guys, now this article is saying that we need to implement AIJS as early as possible. But before that, guys, before coming to this conclusion, we will look a journey that where the AIJS has been supported, where the AIJS has been negated. Now here, guys, we can see that first of all, into the 1986, the Law Commission resurrected the issue and deliberated upon the utility of the AIJS in India. It said that the AIJS should be created. But guys, it was very much criticized at that point of time. It was said that, first of all, the fear was there that the promotional aspects of the judges who are even below the level of district judges, their promotional aspects will be curtailed. Because when they get promoted, they go to the position of district judges. But if they are through AIJS, directly positions will be fulfilled where they will be getting promoted to. So this particular thing was said that it was bad. Then it was said that there is also a language barrier also. If we are choosing a kind of a cadre of all India judges, then guys, obviously a person coming from Jammu and Kashmir might be posted into the Kerala also. But at the lower level, many a times the petitions, the basically the arguments which are made, they are done into the local languages. So how they will be working there? So this is one particular issue that has come. Then guys, even when we talk about the Union, Law Minister has also provided that the All India Judicial Service can be a solution which can provide a equal representation to all the people, because many times it has been seen that the disadvantaged people has not been given a adequate place into the judiciary at the lower level, into the state governments. But here it has been said that such idea had also been negated. It has been said that no, it is wrong, because already Tamil Nadu is providing the reservations up to the tune of 69%, and out of that 30% is for the women also. Then guys, into the UP also 20% reservation to the women is being provided. So whether it will be providing the representation to all is also a kind of a disputed thing. After that guys, it is said that AIJS should be created because it will be helping in reducing the backlog of the cases which has been created. But it is again, counter argument is given that actually large number of cases are being are backpiling, because even at the level below the district judges, the cases are not being cleared swiftly. So the AIJS cannot help. So this idea has been negated. Then guys, now when we talk about the idea of the AIJS, what has happened? In 1960s, the Chief Justice Conference was held and it also favored the creation of the AIJS. But again, the state government, the state high courts had opposed this particular idea. Then guys, there is one particular important committee, that is the First National Judicial Pay Commission. It is also called as the Shetty Commission. It also favored the idea of the AIJS. It was said that it is will be into the favor of judicial health. But guys, again, this particular recommendations have been negated. Now guys, the grand verdict was given into the All India Judges Association versus Union of India case, where the judiciary provided that now AIJS needs to be created because it will be helping to bring a kind of a professional competence at the level of the lower judiciary. But guys, even till now, such a kind of a decision has not been taken. So guys, into this particular article, we have seen many of the landmark steps where AIJS was proposed and then many of the areas where the AIJS was negated. Fine. So guys, that is all about this particular article. But whether the AIJS will be helping or not, both the arguments has been there. There cannot be a very clear-cut answer. Is it clear? There are the apprehensions as well as there are the prospects. So that is all about it. And now guys, we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper and it is talking about the Nipun Bharat mission. Guys, this Nipun Bharat mission, it was finalized very recently, and guys, yesterday, that is on Monday, it has also been formally announced. Is it clear? Already we have seen the Nipun Bharat Abhiyan. We have seen that under the Nipun Bharat Abhiyan, what government is trying to do? Government is trying to put a kind of a deadline, that is by 26-27, they will make sure that every child into the class 3 is having the ability, has having the foundational ability to read, to write, as well as to perform the basic arithmetic. Is it clear? Now what has happened? It has now been provided by the government that as we need to achieve the target by 26-27, today we need to assess that where we are standing today. So for that particular thing, a national achievement survey will be carried by the government by the month of November this year, and a kind of a baseline will be created, and on to the basis of that baseline we will assess from time to time whether we are performing good or not. So this particular new development has happened here. So guys, already yesterday Nipun Bharat we have seen, fine, so you can refer to that particular attachment. And guys, in addition, what has happened, a very good line has been used into this particular article, that why the foundational ability is very much important. Please focus here. It has been said that until grade 3, children are expected to learn to read and acquire basic skills. But after grade 3, children are expected to be able to read to learn. Fine. Earlier what they do? Earlier they learn how to read. If they will not be learning effectively how to read, later they cannot read to learn new things. So therefore the foundational ability is very much important. Guys, we see that a very big gap is existing in India, where even after the class 3, children are not able to read. If they are not able to read, they cannot learn. Fine. So basically the Nipun Bharat Abhiyan is trying to fulfill the agenda of providing the qualitative education, which was envisaged into the new education policy of 2020 also. Government will be doing everything into this direction. They will change the pedagogical skill, they will train the teachers, and all such kind of things will be happening. So that is all about this particular article, guys. Now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article has been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and guys, it is just a kind of a small passing reference that you can utilize in any of your answers related to the privacy issues. Now, what has happened? You know this particular thing that government is carrying the vaccination. But guys, now it has came to the light that Ministry of Health and Family Welfare is using the facial recognition technology to identify the vaccine beneficiaries. Fine. Now, a issue has been emerged that neither a legal order is existing, now the direction, nor the direction has been given by the central government, nor the judiciary has directed that, okay, you can use the facial recognition technology. So a question is coming that how the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare is doing it without having a legal mandate. And therefore, guys, it has also been said that it might be a violation of kind, it might be a clear-cut violation where the overstepping is being done by the Ministry of Health. Now, it has been said that earlier, the authentication by the facial recognition was being carried for many of the advantages, but it was before the COVID-19 or and for different schemes. Fine. So, this is all about this particular issue, guys. Fine. So, kind of a brief aspect or a development, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, guys, basically, these two articles have been taken from the Hindu newspaper, and here we can see what has happened. Two of the developments had happened. First of all, the UK India Business Council, it has made some observation with respect to the reform process that is being carried by the India. First of all, guys, we came out with the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, under which we said that we want to make the self-sufficiency into India. But in order to create the self-sufficiency, what has been done? Indian government had increased the custom duties on many of the goods so that Indian, basically, so that the import gets restricted and our domestic manufacturers get a more motivation to develop those goods in-house. But the UK India Business Council says that this particular thing is not going in line with the free trade, with the liberalized trade that India has always talked about. Is it clear? So guys, this is just the basic idea that has been carried into this particular article. Then guys, further it has the same UK India Business Council had also shown some concerns with respect to India's policy with respect to the space liberalization. So under the Atmanirbhar Bharat Abhiyan, we also carried the space liberalization and we said that the 100% FDI is allowed into the space sector. And as a part of that 100% FDI, we are now inviting the private players. But guys, it has been said that what is happening into the India, there is a Department of Space, which is the regulator of the space sector. And at the same time, the Department of Space is also the head organization over the ISRO. Is it clear? So ISRO, Indian Space Research Organization, is also playing into the field of space exploration. So when the private players will be coming and will be submitting their proposal for any particular aspect, obviously, guys, the ISRO will also be submitting their own proposal for the same thing. And when these proposals will be going to the Department of Space, how objectively it will decide that the fair chance is being given to the other players also? How it will be making sure that if into the situation, there is not a conflict of interest, it is not unduly favoring the ISRO. For this particular thing, no policy has came out, no framework has came out, and it is sending the ambiguous signals to the players who want to come into the space exploration into the India. So guys, these are two basic observations that had been made by the UK India Business Council. Fine. Apart from that, guys, there is no factual or no basically policy related measure. So guys, that is all about the today's newspaper analysis. I hope that you are understanding all these articles and you are finding this initiative fruitful. That is all for today. Thank you so much.